Okay, so today it's the final lecture, and we will dedicate it to the study of expanders. So as I mentioned earlier, these are graphs that have constant degree. In fact, they are d-regular. But very high connectivity. That is to say, it's almost a random graph. And in some sense, it is close to a complete graph. So we will see what I mean by that by the end of the lecture. Okay? So this seems to be contradictory, okay, having a linear number of edges, okay, but still the connectivity of the complete graph. So the interesting thing about expanders is that they are very useful. I mean, this is a very powerful tool. What do I mean by that? I mean that it has application in network design. It has application in embeddings, metric embeddings. It has application in approximation algorithm. It has a lot of application in complexity theory. Especially for de-randomizing. But not only that. In fact, expanders are a very good way to save random bits. So we'll see that by the end of this lecture. But also in coding theory, with the design of efficient low density code, and etc. Okay. There's a lot of places where this matters. Okay, so we will try in these 3 hours to go through most of their properties. Okay, so it will be a challenge to prove everything. So I will send you a reference by email. On a full a paper completely covering most of the aspect of expanders. So for the courageous people who want to read a lot, then they will be able to follow this this work. But I think that we will be able to do most of it. Okay, it's 120 pages paper. Okay. Okay, so. Can I erase? Okay, so let's now first define what do I mean by expander. What do I mean by expander? So in order to define what I mean by expander, I will define what we mean by expansion. What is the expansion of a graph? Okay, so the expansion of a graph is its ability to spread its edge to every part, okay? And this is captured by the following definition. Okay, so let G be a graph. So a d-regular graph. D-regular graph. So d-regular means that for all vertex u, the degree of u is d, where d is a fixed constant. Okay. So and all the graphs that we will consider in this lecture will be d-regular. Okay. So in particular, the number of edges is it's n d over 2, but it's not really n d over 2 because we consider Let's say that the sum of a degree, let's say that, is nd. Okay? So by the way, by graph, in this lecture, I will mean multigraph. Multigraph, that means that several edges, you can repeat each edge several times if you feel like. Okay? So for instance, in this graph here, the degree of this node is 3. Okay, and the degree of this node is 4. What do you count is the number of output of each vertex. Okay? So this is just one output. You just go from here and get back to here. Okay? If I just add, for instance, another vertex here with two self loops, here its degree is 3. Okay? Basically, what we want to do with these expanders is do random walks on them. Okay? And what counts when you have a self loop? It means that you have one exit that goes to the same place. Okay? So it's just one exit. Okay? And here there are two because there are two self loops. Okay? So these are just multigraphs. Okay? It's no big deal. Good. So let G be a derregular graph. Okay? The expansion of G is h of g, the mean over all the subset of vertices such that their size is at most half of the vertices, okay, of the number of edges between S and its complementary over d times the size of S. Sometimes d is present, sometimes d is not present, okay. In this lecture, we place d. Okay, it's just a normalizing constant. Okay, d is the degree of the d-regular graph. It's just a constant. It doesn't really matter the value of this constant. Okay. So you have that. So let's look at it closely. What does this mean? This means that if you look at the set of vertices here, v, okay, you consider any set S that does not cover more than half of the graph. Okay, then the number of edges that goes from outside S is at least h of g times the size of S. Okay, somehow these blue edges here, you can see them as the size of the frontier of the set S. Okay, it's the boundary of the set S somehow. Okay, it's its connection with the outside of S. And here, basically, size of S is somehow the volume of S. Okay? So you can see this ratio here. Okay, it's as an isoperimetric ratio. Remember about the, for instance, you ask the question of what is the surface that minimizes the ratio between the size of its boundary and its volume, and the answer is the circle. Okay, if you want to have a maximum volume with the smallest surface, you get a circle. Okay, here that's basically what we are looking for. Okay, we are looking for a graph G such that its expansion is as large as possible. Okay? And what is this expansion? Its expansion is the minimum over all the possible subgraph, okay? So part of G, of the frontier, the size of the boundary of this set over its volume. Okay? So that's basically the same idea here. Okay? You want to find something that, you know, you can pack as much as you can in it somehow. Okay? So we will use this vision later on to make connections with matrix. Okay? So what is an expander? We'll say that G is an N D H expander if First of all, J is D-regular and has n vertex, n vertices. Okay. And two, H of G is at least H. Okay. So this is an expander. This is what we call an expander. Okay. And we say that for some, let's say, constant H. Okay. Exactly, but not with H with equal to a constant. Okay. So that's a good point. So what we define now, and GI, an infinite family, GI is a family of ND epsilon expander if D epsilon expanders, okay. If the size of VI goes to infinity, and for all I, GI is the size of VI D epsilon expander. Okay, of course, as usual in computer science, we don't care about we care about a single input, but the important thing is how does it evolve when n goes to infinity. Okay, and what we want is that we will have a family of expander, okay, if the expansion does not decrease as the size of a graph grow. Okay, the expansion is independent of the size of a graph. So what does this mean concretely? This means that we will be able to find with a linear number of edges, okay, a way to have the connectivity of a random graph. Do you remember about the calculation we made last time? This is true for random graphs, okay, but with an expansion which is important, which is D. Okay, so the question is, does it exist? Okay, because it's nice to define a nice object, but the first question is, does there exist some such objects? And the answer is yes. And in order to prove that such objects exist, we will use a technique which is called the probabilistic method. So does anyone know about the probabilistic method? What it consists? Yes? Yeah, exactly. Okay. So the basic idea is that we define a distribution on something, okay, and we show that the probability that this something verifies the property that we want is positive. And it follows that there is something that has the probability, the property. Okay? It's just to say that the probability of some event, okay, it's simply the number of elementary event that verifies that belongs to A over the size of the space, quoi. So if this probability is positive, then this means that there are some people in A. Okay, so A is not empty. That's what we will show. So in fact, it's even more than that. It's most of the graphs are expanders, more or less. That's what we will show. I mean, a huge part of the graphs will be expanders. So in order to prove that, we will simply do the following. We will consider random bipartite graph. So we will consider random bipartite graph, and we will define. So let G be bipartite. Graph D-regular on the left side. Okay, so this means that the graph is a bipartite, so it's a graph G, which consists in a left part, a right part, and a set of edges. Okay, and we want regular on the, irregular on the left side. That means that for all u in the left side, the left side, the mu of u equals d. So we have a graph which is irregular on the left side.
So the expansion normalizes the number between 0 and 1 if you normalize it with d?
Yes. More or less. Yes, of course, because you cannot have more than d neighbors. But it's not between 0 and 1. It's between 0 and 1. It can be 0. Yeah. In the case of a disconnected graph, it's 0. Okay, so bipartite graph, irregular on another. Okay, we will. Okay, so let this is n1 and the size of the right side is n2. Okay, or since we have a degree. Yeah, let's say that the size of the left side is n, and the size of the right side in m is m. Okay, it's because we have a derregular graph, it's bipartite, so we can use m as the size of the right part. So, so a bipartite graph, you have L, you have R, R here, and all the edges are between L and, L and R. Okay, so we say that G is N, M, D, let's say magic graph. If one for all, if for all S, so we will just focus on the left side and show the expansion for the left side. Okay, so I consider only set S that are included in the left side. Okay, and what we have is the neighborhood. Oh, this is, by the way, the set of the neighbors of the nodes in S with multiplicity. Okay, so for instance, if I have a node U here with neighbor V like that, the gamma of U is the multiset VV. Okay, V appears twice in gamma of U. Okay, it's a multiset. So gamma of S is larger than 5D over 8 size of S for all S in L. Okay, no. If S is not too big, then D. Okay. And two, I have a different majoration if L over 10D and okay. So depending on D, as soon as D is larger than 8 over 5, it's just that the expansion of this graph is 1. 1 over D.
N is the size of L?
N is the size of L. Okay. So let's say that we give this definition. Okay, we don't care so much about the constant. It's just that it makes the proof work. Okay, but what we will show basically is that we will be able to find a irregular graph, okay, who has the expansion property from left to right. Okay, a irregular bipartite graph that has the expansion to left to right. So basically, what's going on is usually what we, when we use the probabilistic method, there is some kind of, in this kind of property, you know, as the degree will increase, this will be more and more likely somehow. Okay? And somehow we will have a phase transition. And on both sides of the phase transition, you can just use very, very rough crude bounds. Okay?
Because basically, before, it's completely unlikely, but once it's likely, it's very, very likely. Okay? So the key in this kind of proof is just to use the most crude bounds that you can. Okay? So it will be kind of shocking that it works, but it's because of the moral of phase transition somehow. So basically, what we will show is the following lemma. Is that there exists an N0 such that for all n larger than N0, d larger than 32, and m larger than 3/4 of n, okay, then a random bipartite left d-regular graph, the probability that a random bipartite left d-regular graph is an expander, a magic graph, is larger than what? Larger than something, I don't remember the constant.
So, we will prove it, but let's try to show, get the right constant.
Ah, no, we just prove that there exists. Okay. Okay, but we will prove that it's omega of n. So what do I mean by random bipartite left d-regular graphs? I just pick, so the proof is the following. So so you take n, d, and m verifying these inequalities. Okay, we will fix n0 of, by the end. Okay, so basically we have a set L here, and a set R, and we construct a random graph. Okay, this random graph for each node U here, each node U on the left side, it will pick with replacement D random vertex in R. Okay? So the process. So each U in L pick D random vertices independently in R, okay, and these are its neighbors. So now we want to check these two properties. Okay. And we want to make sure that they are verified with high probability, with high enough probability. So I will not conduct the calculation up to the end, okay, but I will just give a flavor of it. So basically, what's the spirit of it? So again, what I said is that you can be very crude, okay, in the bounding. So what you do is simply, okay, so for each S in L, with S less than n over 10d, okay, we will show that it is unlikely that there exists a t in R with size of t less than 5d over 8 size of s, such that the neighborhood of s is included in t. Okay? So basically, what do? I look at all the s all the S in L, okay, of size at most n over d, then 10d. I look at all the t in R of size at most 5d over 8s. Okay, and I will try to evaluate the probability that the whole neighborhood of S is inside t. And I will sum over all this S and t and show that this is unlikely. Okay, so this is very, very cool. Okay, that's a very brutal way of bounding it. So basically, what do I say? I introduce a random variable x st, which is 1 if s is, if the neighborhood of s is included in t and 0 over s.
How do you interpret the inclusion? If
it's inclusion in the sense of sets.
But isn't delta of s a multiset in fact?
Yeah, but we don't care. Yes, yeah, it's inclusion in the sense of multiset. Yeah. Okay. Doesn't matter so much because d is little with respect to n. Well, I don't want to enter into too much detail, okay, but you're right, we have to be careful here, okay? But again, since d is a constant with respect to n and m, we don't care so much, okay? But it's completely unlikely that two nodes end up at the same cell. So gamma of s will be with high probability, very high probability, a set, okay? So we can just get rid of it at the beginning, okay, and then conduct the calculation. I really don't want to enter too much into this detail. Okay, we'll just do half of the proof because it's already we have a lot of things to do. So, okay, so maybe it's half of the proof, but at least it will be close enough to a proof. Okay, so basically, what we want to say is that one will be verified if for all S, for all S such that its size is less than n over 10d, for all t such that its size is at most 5d over 8 size of S, xst equals 0. Okay? Then 1 is verified. So the probability of 1 is thus less by the union bound as the sum over st, verifying size of s less than n over 10d, size of t less than 5d over 8 size of s, of the probability that xt equals 1. Okay, so in fact, I can just focus to the case where t has the maximum size. Okay, again, it doesn't matter so much. It's just, you will just lose a constant factor by doing so. Okay, because if it's included in a smaller set, it's included in a larger one. Okay, and now what is that? What is the probability that all the nodes, the neighbor of S, are in T? Okay, it's simply the size of T over N to the DS, D size of S. Okay, you want that in for the D size of S neighbors of the guys in S, all of them fall in T. And this happens with probability size of T over N. Okay? So you have this ugly sum that you can rewrite as follow. You can rewrite it based on the size of S. So let's say that, let's denote by S, small s, the size of S. So it's equal to the size of N for S from 1 to N over 10D.
And shouldn't you say that in the 1 minus that thing?
What? No. You want them, all of them, to be in T.
No, but the inequality itself. If that's equal to 0, and here we look at the case that they're equal to 1.
Yes, you're right. The quality, but not 1. Okay. Yeah, thank you. The quality that 1 does not work is that. Okay? So you sum over all the possible size of S. So the set S, where N choose S, so that's where the approximation of a multiset raises a little problem, okay? But we don't care because it's negligible. Okay. Then for T, you have M is the size of R. M choose 5D S over 8. Okay, and then T over N is 5 DS over 8 N to the DS. Okay, now you use an inequality, which is N choose K is less than N E over K to the K. Okay, and then some calculation later, okay, it end up to be less than this term here, turned out to be less than 20 to the minus s. Okay, so you just replace it by that and just do all the simplification. So you can check that the degree here, the n and m cancels out, okay, and just remain some constant. Okay, and this is then less than 1/10. Okay, so I'm not conducting the calculation. You can do it by yourself if you feel like, but it's absolutely no interesting point doing it. So basically, the probability that 1 is not verified is just less than 1/10. Okay, so you can conduct exactly the same calculation for 2. Okay, and do exactly the same thing. You introduce a random variable yst, which is the probability that S is totally included in a set T. The gamma of S is totally included in a set T. And with this bound, you do the same calculation and you get that the probability that 2 is not verified is less than something like 1/10 again. Okay? And then you're done. Okay? So it follows by the union bound that the probability that this is a magic graph is larger than 8/10. Which is, okay. So you have a large majority of graphs which have this expansion property from the left to right. Okay. So this is not really an expander here. Okay, because we don't have a symmetry thing. Okay. But for instance, it's good enough to do some amazing stuff. For instance, from that, you can solve a conjecture that was open for a while. And it was related to complexity theory. In fact, in complexity theory, you know, you have one of the main challenges is to get circuit lower bound. Okay, to show that some calculation requires a circuit which is deep enough to be conducted. Okay, and for instance, there was a guy Valiant who just say okay, was thinking about some kind of circuit that was somehow impossible to realize, and. Well, this circuit, what he had in mind was the following, is that you have n inputs, okay, on the one end, n inputs, n outputs there, and you have some circuit here in between. And what you want is that if you take any set S of size k here, any set T of size k here, what you want is k vertex disjoint paths that goes from each of these vertex to some of these vertex here, but all disjoint. Okay, and the question is it possible? With O of n edges. Okay? Okay, and the answer was suspected to be no, but it turns out to be yes. So we don't have a circuit lower bound for this, based on that. So how do you prove that? So it's fairly simple. Now we have these magic graphs here. Okay, this magic graph has a property that if you pick D large enough, okay, this will be one. Okay, how do you solve this problem? So what you say, what you do is, so for n less than n0, remember that this is only true for n larger than some n0, okay? But n0 is a constant, it's an absolute constant, which is independent of everything, okay? So for n less than n0, you just pick the complete graph. Okay, the complete graph verifies this property. The complete graph KNN. Okay, it's, everybody is connected to everyone, so there is no problem. If you have two sets of size K, you can connect each vertex in one bijectively with the other one. Okay, directly, and everybody is So now for N, for n larger than n0, you will do a recursive construction. And the recursive construction works as follows. You take two copies of n, 3n over 4, some d magic graph. Let's say D equals 42. Okay, for instance. Here. So you take two copies of such a graph. So G1, which is L1, R1, and I don't care about the set of edges. G2, L2, R2, P2, and you do the following. You put G1 like that. So you have L1 here, R1 here, and you put G2 like that. So you put L2 here and R2 here. Okay? So you take these two copies. So now you need to connect these two copies. How do you connect them? D, you take, this kind of graph is called the superconcentrator. Okay?
It's called
graph de la mort. Okay. So take a super concentrator with n prime equals 3n over 4. Okay. So you can do it because we are doing the construction inductively.
In the middle, what you did, like a circuit, there is other two? In the middle between the two graphs.
I didn't do anything yet. But I will. Yeah, you have to connect everybody so that for any set of size k here, less than n, for any k, for any set of size k, you want to have k vertex digital and pen that relates a vertex of s bijectively to a vertex of t.
So in the middle, there are also vertices?
Yeah, of course. There are a lot of people here. There are a lot of people in there. So now what you do, and this superconcentrator connecting R1 to R2. Okay, so you put your superconcentrator here with 3n over 4. 3n over 4 connection. Okay, this connect R1 to R2. Okay? And this is not enough. You need to add more edges, of course, because here there is you cannot no more than 3n over 4 vertex digital path can go through. Okay, so you need to add more edges. And you just add a perfect matching. Between L1 and L2. Okay? So I'm just adding a perfect matching here above it. Okay? So now let's prove that it's a super concentrator. Let's prove that indeed we have a super concentrator. So we need to show let's prove that it is a super concentrator. So let's consider K between 1 and N, S included in L, T included in R, T included in L2, okay, with size of S equals size of T equals K. Okay? So we consider an L to, set S to the left, set T to the right, okay, both of equal size K. And let's try to show that we have indeed K vertex disjoint path connecting S to T. How do we do that? So let's consider two cases. If K is less than N over 2. If K is less than N over 2, then what do we know? We know that gamma in G1 of S, because G1 is a magic graph, okay, has the size larger than size of S. Okay? And gamma G1 of S is included in R1. The number of neighbors in G1 of S is at least the size of S. Okay? And it's included in R1. Good. We have the same thing for T with G2. So let me draw the picture here. So you have S here, and you have gamma of S, okay? You have T here, and here you have gamma of T. Okay? Good. So there is a theorem which is called the Hall theorem. By Hall marriage theorem, there exists a perfect matching of S with gamma of S and of T with gamma of T. Okay, you can connect because you have enough space here and enough space there, okay? You can connect this guy with edges. Okay, you have edges, you have a perfect matching here that connects everybody here. Okay? So now we just need to connect these guys with these guys. Okay, but C is a super concentrator. So you have K independent paths that both convert to there. So that's good. You're done. Okay, you have K disjoint path connecting this set S to this tip, set T here. So let's now focus on the case where the size of both sets is larger than N over 2. So we don't have this expansion relation anymore. Okay, this is only true for a set of size at most N over 2. Okay? But what's going on? Is that if K is larger than N over 2, then look at the perfect matching that we had. Okay? Look at gamma of S in the perfect matching. Its size, it's the size of S. which is the size of T, which is K. Okay? Good. So basically, let's see how many vertices in this neighborhood intersect T. So basically, the size of gamma of S intersected with T through the perfect matching, it's the size of S union T. We'll just say something wrong. It's the size of S plus the size of T minus the size of S union T. Size of gamma R. Gamma of S in the perfect matching. Okay, the size of intersection of two sets is the sum of the size of the two sets minus the sum of the union. Okay? This is K. This is K. And this is at most N, because it's included in R. Okay? So this is at least, 2K minus N.
Put M in now?
No, because M equals N.
N equals N.
Yeah. Well, there is no N.
Yeah.
There is no M here. Okay, so you have at least 2k minus n vertices which are directly connected with each other. Okay, so now we apply Al-Mariech theorem again. No, we don't need that yet. Okay, we don't need it now. So now we have handled, so we have connected directly. So we have connected the perfect matching at least 2k minus n vertices of S with vertices of T remains to treat less than k minus n k minus 2k minus n, which is n minus k, which is strictly less than n over 2 vertices, and just do the same as before. Okay, now we are left with sets of size less than n over 2, and we can go through the superconcentrator of size 3/4 of n. Okay? So this is some kind of magic construction. So you use this kind of magic graph, okay? And you're able to build a graph which has very little number of edges. How many edges does it have? It's very simple. Because what's going on here? How does the number of edges increase? You had n edges here. It costs nothing, it's linear. N is linear, okay, so forget about it. You add the expander here, these two expanders. These two expanders have a linear number of edges. So good, it's linear, we don't care. Okay? And plus what? Plus the size, the number of edges in a superconcentrator of size 3/4 of the current size. Okay, so you have an exponential decrease in the size. So remember that the sum of some constant to the I, it's still some constant less than 1, it's big O of I. Okay, so it will be linear. Okay, so you have something like sum of C to the I times N, which is less than big O of I. Okay, so you get a graph which has indeed a linear number of edges, and which is able to do this amazing connectivity. Okay. So the big problem with the proof that we have now is that we don't know how to construct expander. We just know that they exist, and it it was for a very, very long time that we did not know how to construct them. Okay? We knew that they exist, we knew that they exist with Rho 81, but we did not know how to build them. Okay? More importantly, what we need for most of the application is to be able to describe them very, very, very economically. Okay? And basically, what we want basically to be able to do is that in an expander, being able to tell in very fast, what are the neighbors of some node. Okay, that's basically what we need. Okay, given a node U in the expander, we want to have a list of its neighbors. That's all we care about. Why? Because basically, we will, most of the time, in the application we want, we won't be able to describe the whole expander because we will require it to have an exponential size. Okay, for instance, if your algorithm runs in poly of n time, we will use an expander of size 2 to the poly of n. Okay? And then it's impossible to describe it in polynomial time. Okay? But since the degree is bounded, okay, we can hope to get the list of the neighbors of each node that we go through in polynomial time. Okay? And that's basically what we use. So I don't think we will be able to go through this construction today, okay? But I will give you the key to understand it. Okay, how do you construct dependence?
If you say that you can just pick a random graph and it will be as such property.
Yeah, but you won't be able to compute the list of vertex. Okay, So one important thing is that you don't want to pick a random graph, because basically what you want to do is to get rid of random bits. Okay, so you want basically what they are best at, the expanders, is that they allows you to use much less random bits. But if you use an exponential number of bits at the beginning to construct the graph, then you it's useless. Okay, so the key is really to have a deterministic construction of expanders in order to get the speed up you want. Okay, so we've seen that it exists, we've seen that they allow to do some amazing stuff. Okay, so now let's try to understand better how to construct them. Okay, in order to understand better how to construct them, we will do some linear algebra. And we will see, maybe you've seen already, who knows about the graph spectral theory? Yeah? Okay. Two. Good. So, basically, the idea behind the graph spectral theory is that you can capture a lot of properties of a graph by looking at the eigenvalues of its adjacency matrix. Okay? And it's a kind of magic. It's really beautiful. And this allows you to use powerful tools from linear algebra and also to understand a lot the construction. So what do I mean by that? So let's look at graph spectral analysis. Okay. 2.A. Spectrum of graph. So I will not cover this subject in detail. Okay, you have books on that, and I will just cover the thing that we need. So first, in this section again, let G will be a d-regular graph. With n vertices. Okay? So, the agency matrix of G is the matrix A indexed on the vertices, okay, such that UV is the number of edges between U and V. Okay? So if you and if AUU, for instance, AUU is the number of self loops. Self loop AU. Okay. So if you have self loops, okay, so if you had one self loop, AUU equals one. Okay? So this is not really convenient, and the best is to use the transition matrix. Of G is simply you normalize A so that all of its line and all of its column sum to one. Okay? So what so you divide it by D. So fact 1. M is a real symmetric matrix. Okay, so if you exchange U and V, it's still the number of edges between U and V. Okay, so it's the same value. And it's real because it's an integer. And 2, M is doubly stochastic. That means that for all U, the sum over V of MUV equals 1. And also, for all V, the sum over U of MUV equals 1. So why is it so? Why is it so? It's simply because the sum over a line of everything is the sum of the number of edges of U with all the vertices in the graph, and it's simply the degree of U over D, which is 1. Okay? When you sum a line along a line in the adjacent symmetrix, you just get the degree. And since it's a symmetric matrix, okay, it's just the same by summing over a column.
Symmetric because the graph is not directional, right?
Yes, yeah, the graph is not directional, it's undirected. Okay, so it's a symmetric matrix, so you can decompose it on an orthonormal base of eigenvectors. And all the eigenvalues, so eigenvalues means valeur propre, the vector propre. Okay. German English word. So theorem from linear algebra. Oh yeah, I need to define a scalar product first. Well, okay. Let's define it here. So now we consider a scalar product, okay? So we define on Rn, okay, scalar product, the scalar product. So Rn, it's line vectors. It's more convenient for random walks to use line vectors, okay, to multiply by the right. So on X, the scalar product xy is simply x transpose y, which is the sum over all the vertices in V of xu. Okay? It's just the classical scalar product. In particular, the norm 2 of x square is simply the sum of all the vertices of xu square. Okay? So once we have this scalar product, we can define, we can show the following. So since M is a real symétrique matrix.